Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation. So I would like to apologize for not being able to speak in French. So it was not time enough for learning and doing all the work here. So I would like to start talking about some old equisingularity problems by Sarisky. Okay, so I try to get not to assume too much in the talk. So the context is equisingularity. And equisingularity was born, so the original motivation was resolution of singularities, and what people was trying was to understand how singular an algebraic variety could be, or how to distinguish, or how to compare two singular points of an algebraic variety. So for simplicity, and because it is the case that it will be used in my talk, I am going to take a polynomial in n complex variables, and I will look at the origin, for example. And now the point is singular if and only if all the partials of P with respect to xi equals 0. And in this case, you cannot apply the implicit function theorem, and the geometry near the singularity can be arbitrarily complicated. Okay, so you can try to measure topologically how singular, or you can try to compare topologically how singular a polynomial is. And then you, it makes sense to make the following definition. Yeah, so you take X, the hypersurface defined by P, so that is the set of zeros. Okay, and now you take two hypersurfaces. You take the Jermat zero, and you want to know when Cn x zero is topologically equisingular to Cn y zero. And this is exactly when there exists the germ of homeomorphism from Cn zero to Cn zero, such that phi of x equals y. So this means that the ambient topology is the same. Okay, and in this context, Sarisky posed the following two questions. So the question A. Suppose x and y are topologically equisingular. Yeah. Is it true that the multiplicity of x at the origin is the multiplicity of y at the origin? So this is a the first question, and now let me remind what is the multiplicity. You can write P in homogeneous forms. And there is always a first form, and M is the multiplicity of P. I apologize for people that know all this by heart, but I'm trying to make a general public talk. Okay, and the second question is the following. So it's same assumption. So this assumption goes for questions A and B. And now, is it true that, I have to say that X is defined by a polynomial P, and y is defined by a polynomial Q. Okay. And you can write P equals Pm plus higher. And let's write Q equal Qm prime plus higher. And the question is whether the projectivized tangent cone, so the initial form, defines a set in the projective space. And the question is whether the projectivized tangent cone of the two hypersurfaces are homeomorphic. Probably Sarisky was thinking that you first have to prove question A, and then you have to prove question B, because if the multiplicities are not the same, you don't expect the homeomorphism. What is? This is V of Pm is the equation Pm equals zero, but in the projective space. Yeah. Okay, so these are the questions that we are going to analyze in this lecture. And they have a long history, and I will not explain the history of contributions. So there are many good surveys on that, so I'll just go to the point. So in order to understand a bit more these questions, I am going to give a crash course. 5-10 minutes crash course of topology of hypersurface singularities. So the first thing you need to know is that you have a conical structure theorem. And this says the following. There exists a positive epsilon such that the ball of radius epsilon, comma, x intersection the ball of radius epsilon, is the topological cone over the sphere of radius epsilon and the sphere of radius epsilon intersection with x. So this means that locally in a ball, what you find is really a topological cone. Okay, so if you want to understand the topology, the ambient topology of X, you really have to look at a small sphere. So it has been proven by several authors that indeed this pair S epsilon is called the link or the embedded link X at zero. And then by the conical structure theorem, it is clear that the embedded link of X at zero determines the ambient topology. And the converse is true at least for isolated singularities, which is the main object of this talk. Proved by several authors. Okay, and the other very important theorem that we should keep in mind is Miller vibration theorem. And it says that there exists epsilon sufficiently small and delta, which is usually very positive but very small in comparison with epsilon, such that, well, now I will write two kinds of Miller vibrations, A. So I will take the sphere of radius epsilon. I will remove P minus 1 of 0. And now I will send this to S1 by the mapping P divided by the modulus of P. Okay, so this is a locally trivial vibration. So for this vibration, you only need epsilon. And now you can take the ball of radius epsilon. You intersect it with the preimage of the boundary of the disk of radius delta. You send it to the disk of radius delta. And this is also a locally trivial vibration. And both vibrations are the same. Infinity, the same. Okay, so this is Milner vibration theorem. Yeah, so the usual picture is this one. Okay. This is the disk of radius delta, and this is the Milner fiber. So we will use the notation FP, and this is the Milner fiber. And this is F minus 1 of delta, intersection B epsilon. And if you want to have some picture in mind, so to have some example in mind, let me write in this blackboard what you obtain if you take P of x, y equals y squared minus x cubed. In this case, the embedded link is the threefold knot. And I will not picture it because I am bad at this. And the Milner vibration, the Milner fiber, is a torus with one hole. And if you want to understand the Milner vibration, you can do the following picture. At least you understand it homotopically. So you can take 2 points, you can take 3 points, and now you can connect each point on the left with each point on the right. So I connect this with this, and that's all. Okay, so just don't put crossings. Okay, and the Milner fiber retracts to this graph, and now you can permute these 2 points, and you can permute cyclically these 3 points, and this is a model for the monodromy. Okay, so the monodromy is what happens when you go around. Of course, you can take many models for the monodromy. The monodromy is an element in the mapping class group of the Milner fiber. And certainly, you can take a symplectic model that we will use later in this talk. Symplectic model for the monodromy is the following. So you can take omega, the standard symplectic form in Cn. Yeah, and now Fp with omega restricted to Fp. This is a symplectic manifold with boundary. Actually, you know that the symplectic form, the usual symplectic form in Cn is exact. It's the differential of a one form. Okay. And now what you can do is to take this, there is a symplectic connection associated to the symplectic structure, and then if you leave the symplectic connection, it produces a symplectic diffeomorphism from the, so you leave the symplectic connection and walk around the disk, and this produces some symplectomorphism from the Milnor fiber. With the symplectic form to itself. So it happens that it is a symplectomorphism, but it is even an exact symplectomorphism. So this means that if you pull back the 1 for theta and you subtract theta, you get the differential of some function f phi, where f phi goes from the Milnor fiber to R. So this is called the axiom. And this will be very important later in the talk, because we will do Floer theory for the Milnor fiber. Okay, so I think in order to save time, so this is not needed for the next 5-10 minutes, but it will be used later, and I think it's better to introduce it here. Okay, so you have a monodromy, and you have and you know that there are representatives for the Milnor monodromy. Actually, this phi can be taken compactly supported. Which essentially means that phi is the identity close to the boundary. Five. Yeah, very good. So now let me tell some old problems. So what can you say about the Milnor fiber? So there are two cases that behave in a very different way. So P as an isolated singularity at the origin, then you can compute this algebra. You can compute this, the dimension of the Milnor algebra. So you divide the polynomials by the Jacobian ideal. An isolated singularity means precisely that this dimension is finite, because isolated singularity means that the set where all the partial derivatives vanish is an isolated point. So this is called the Milnor number. And then you have a bouquet theorem that tells you that the Milnor fiber of P is a bouquet of mu spheres of dimension n minus 1, and the non-isolated case so this is very wild, so you can say that FP is n minus s minus 2 connected, where s is the dimension of the singular set, and you cannot say much more. So in fact, besides this, so the Milnor fiber can be homotopy equivalent to the complement of any complex analytic set. So this means that everything can happen. Yeah. So this is the Kato Matsumoto. And now is the moment to know how much time I used. Just to modulate a little bit. So my, how much time do I have now? Almost half an hour. Okay. Yeah. So let me say one more old theorem. Yeah, there is a theorem. Write this here. That says that mu is a embedded topological invariant. So the embedded topology determines mu. There is another theorem. This is this is King and Perron. Perron, that the case of dimension of n equal 3 is very special because you get a 3 and 4 dimensional topology. Is that the embedded topological type? Yeah. Is the same information that Milnor vibration. And it is very important. This is for isolated singularities. So if you want to understand the embedded topology, you only have to think on the Milnor vibration for isolated singularities. And another theorem that is very important in our context. This is by Le Ramanujan. And now with some extensions by King and Timurian. And says that if you get PS, and now you get a family of polynomials that depend on a parameter S, so the coefficients depend on a parameter X, is a family with constant Milnor number. Then any two members of the family have the same topological type, embedded topological type. Okay, and this is there is a very important hypothesis, that is n has to be different from 3. And this is due to the use of, yeah, it doesn't depend on S. It doesn't depend on S. But it is very important to say that n has to be different from 3. And case n equal 3 is an important open problem. So the reason why n equal 3 is there is because H covertis has to be used. And yeah, this is not true in this dimension. And yeah, nobody knows. I suppose this is true, but nobody knows how to prove. Yeah, but this this theorem motivates the following question, that is the one that is we are going to address in this lecture. So this theorem, together with Sarisky question, motivates the question mu constant implies, oh no, small a, constant multiplicity. And B, topology for the projective eyes. Okay. Pardon? Mu constant implies that mu of PS does not depend on S. You have a one parameter family of polynomial and you impose that the Miller number is constant. So this is a completely algebraic question because you are saying that the dimension over C of x1, xn divided by the partial of ps with respect to x1, partial of ps with respect to xn, independent on S implies that the multiplicity is independent of S. So we have turned some topological problem into a problem of algebra. And in fact, now it is worth to comment that this is the origin of the computer algebra program Singular. In fact, Groyer and Pfister created Singular because they wanted to give counterexamples to this statement and they needed computing power because, yeah, this is very slow. If you want to do this by hand, it's a nightmare. Yeah. Okay, so now, I want to, so let's lose hope for problem B. So in 2004, so here I want to do some geographical comments because CIRM is involved, but also EHES. So I was 2 weeks in EHES and I found the following example. Okay, and this family is mu constant. This family is mu constant. It is even Whitney equisingular. For those that know what is this. But, okay, so the multiplicity is 3. So this is, I should call it P because this is the notation. This is P, 3, P. But the topology of P, 3, 0. So these two things are not homeomorphic. Yes. So this immediately, okay, so this happened in EHES and the first time that I communicate this to a mathematician different from myself was in CIRM in the chapel room. In the Sao Carlos meeting of singularities that happened that summer. Yeah, so this is wrong. But in the rest of the lecture, I will explain what remains true of this conjecture. Okay, so now let's go to positive results. And yeah, for this, where is the race? Yeah. I think I will stay here. Okay, so the next thing is a campo. But also, I will talk about results of a campo, but also le. That they studied. Dynamical properties of the Miller vibration. So in particular, they asked the question whether the monodromy must have fixed points or whether powers of the monodromy must have fixed points. So then by Lipschitz fixed point theorem, you know that what you have to do is to compute the Lipschitz numbers of the iterate of the monodromy. Okay, so this is and the method that was employed by Acampo was a resolution method. So you have your polynomial. And now you consider embedded resolution of singularities, and this means that you write down your polynomial. Here is an embedded resolution of singularities for the singularity y squared minus x cubed. So you write your polynomial in such a way, so you take a proper modification such that pi composed with pi is normal crossings. And this means that locally at this point, if this divisor, so if p composed with pi can be written as y to the power mi, where mi is some multiplicity, so you can say that the pullback of the divisor x, where x is b of pi, is the sum of mi ei. This goes from 0 up to and number n, and I will reserve the index 0 for the strict transform. Okay, and in a close to a box, I am doing the curve case for simplicity, but the general case is of the same form. So you just write more variables. Okay, so you consider a resolution of singularities in such a way. In such a way that you have these normal forms. And then the following happens. Now you split the space in tubular neighborhoods of the exceptional divisors or of the total transform of X. And now the Milnor fiber, when the radius is very small, the Milnor fiber is spread in these neighborhoods. So you write your Milnor fiber as a union from I equal 1 up to n on of what I will call in this talk VI. Okay, so VI is the piece of Milnor fiber that is in the tubular neighborhood around the divisor EI. And union, let's call some connecting annuli. So we don't need to understand too much what is the piece of the Milnor fiber here, because it is proved that that piece of the Milnor fiber is a union of tori, and tori has, they have zero Euler characteristics, so they are not important for the computation of the Lipschitz number. Okay, and then with this kind of picture in mind, Acampo was able to prove that the Lipschitz number of the monodromy equals zero if m is smaller than the multiplicity of p, but he was not able to prove, and I think it is false, that this is different from zero for any polynomial. So if he could prove that, then Sarisky multiplicity conjecture would be true immediately, because the Milnor fibration is a topological information, and then you would be able to detect the multiplicity from the topological information of the Milnor fibration. Yeah, so this is this. So now the story continues with two important observations. So the first observation is that the Lipschitz number of phi m is the Euler characteristic of the and now the talk is going to be a bit faster of the Floer homology of the diffeomorphism, and on the other hand it is the Euler characteristic the contact loci. So just let me tell you what are these terms. So I told you before that the Milnor monodromy was a symplectic, was an exact symplectic, it was an exact symplectomorphism. To an exact symplectomorphism, Seidel, and also see the work of Uliarevic, he associated a Floer homology group, and the Euler characteristic is this minus 1 to the power n. I might be writing the sign wrong. Yeah. And what is the contact locus? The contact locus is the following thing. It is a purely algebraic object. So you take the set of maps from a spectrum of t to the power tn plus 1 to c, and inside of this map you take those such that satisfies. So this is something that you can write by just by equations. It's a very easy space, so well, very easy to define a space. It's hard to compute. Yeah, and yeah, so this this was an observation by Seidel, and this observation was by Deneuve and Loesser. And then there was in the ambient, what is the relation between Floer theory and the cohomology of contact locus? And I want to explain a little bit of this. So for this, I am going to, I need to explain an important contribution by MacLean. So this is essentially the breakthrough that allowed for the results that I am hinting in this lecture. So there is a spectral sequence such that the first term is the following. So let me hn minus p plus q minus 2k I a I plus 1 and now vi. Okay. So I will not explain what are these terms. These terms are easy to define in terms of a resolution, but they are irrelevant for the rest of the talk. Okay. What is important is that with this spectral sequence, you immediately recover the result of a campo that the Lipschitz number for the I have to say something important. Pi from y to cn is what is called an M separating resolution. Okay, so an M separating resolution has the following property. An M separating resolution has the following property. If EI intersect EJ, okay, so I recall that the total transform was expressed as this sum. So if EI intersects EJ, MI has to plus MJ has to be strictly bigger than M. M separating resolutions, so this is the M separating condition. Okay, so, and it is true that you can always produce an M separating resolution. And this is for any M separating resolution. And a consequence is that the Floer homology, the corollary, is that the Floer homology, and the multiplicity is different from zero, because in the spectral sequence, only one term, that is the term related to the tangent cone, appears. So the corollary is that the M, the multiplicity of P, is the smallest M, such that the Floer homology is different from zero. Okay, so shortly after, we produce a similar spectral sequence for the cohomology of contact loci. So with the theorem with Boudour that says that there is a spectral sequence with up to reindexing same term but it converges to the compactly supported cohomology of the contact locus. Yeah, and we formulated the conjecture that for every M, there is an isomorphism of spectral sequences Yeah, and I have to make an important precision. So here I is different from zero. So the strict transform component does not appear. Yeah. Yeah, of a spectral sequence. And as a consequence, the conjectural relation, so the precise conjectural relation, is that up to reindexing, this should be the compactly supported cohomology of the contact. Okay. And we proved that the conjecture is true. The multiplicity of. Okay, so now I am going to state the main result because I am running out of time. Yeah. So I will skip a little bit the method of proof. And now I want to state the result. That was proved by myself and Thomas Pelka. And this happened this summer in the Villa room in CIRM. I think I will have to beg for 2 or 3 minutes. Yeah, so, yeah. So now you take P from Cn to C, polynomial. With isolated singularities. Yeah, and now you take a ball. You take a ball such that P minus 1 of 0 intersects transversely the boundary sphere. But this ball does not need to be small at all. So you could have that the central fiber has 2, 3 several singularities, and that the radius of the ball is large. So we don't necessarily deal with the Miller vibration. Okay, so we consider. So we have a vibration for a disk of sufficiently small radius to the boundary of the disk. We have a vibration, P, right. So this is a vibration with symplectic monodromy. Why? Okay, we, as before, I am going to call F the fiber. And we modify MacLean result to find a spectral sequence E1 PQ. And now the point is you get H, same set of indexes. But here you have to write BI. And there is a thing that you write exterior boundary of BI. So let me say what is the exterior boundary. I don't have a resolution of singularity, so I have to picture it. So let me resolve that case. So you could get, you have to resolve 2 singular points, and you have some component, which is the strict transform. So the exterior boundary, and you have a ball. Let me take the preimage of the ball. The preimage of the ball can be pictured like this. Okay. And then the Milnor fiber has to look like this. No, I don't. I won't picture the whole of it. Okay, and now you have the boxes and so on. And now there is only one BI that have an exterior boundary. The exterior boundary is the intersection of the yellow with the red thing. Okay, so to be able to prove this, there is some methodological change in the, so we cannot follow MacLean proof. So we have to find a completely different proof of the spectral sequence. But as a consequence of our methods, we are able to obtain this result. And now let me apply this result to a mu constant family. Yes. I should mention and I should write. So they convert to the same thing. Okay. So they are this, yeah. So you may wonder why they convert to the same thing if our spectral sequence has one extra term. And I am going to explain this immediately. So I will explain it by proving Sarisky conjecture A for families. So now I take a mu constant family. Okay, so what you do, so you fix a radius epsilon zero for the zero parameter of the family. You take the same radius for an small s different from zero. Transversality is an open property, so if you take s small enough, it will be preserved. So it happens that the Milnor radius for s different from zero can be very small. It can be shrink to zero as you approach. Okay, so the reason why you cannot directly apply MacLean spectral sequence to prove Sarisky conjecture A in family is that you are not able to control this symplectic coverage. So what we do instead is to compare this vibration with this vibration. Okay, so it is known that when you modify by an isotopy, the Floer theory does not change. Okay, so the Floer theory of this fiber, together with the nth iterate of the monodromy, is the same that the Floer theory of this fiber, together with the nth iterate of the monodromy. Once you know this, you analyze each of the cases separately. So let me take this one that is the most difficult one. So you make resolution of singularities. Yeah, so it's 30 seconds. Make resolution of singularities and you get a long neck. So you get a box, and now it is possible to prove that this is a trivial covertis, homologically trivial covertis. Okay, so this is the extra piece that appears here. But since this is a homologically trivial covertis, its relative homology with respect to the exterior boundary is equal to zero. So this is the formulation of a homologically trivial covertis. So this thing contributes to nothing, and then we find the multiplicity back. Okay, so this proves Sarisky question A in family, but as a bonus, I told that this conjecture is true for the multiplicity m, and then what you obtain, once you know that the multiplicity is the same, is that the Floer homology of the Miller fiber of P0 is the Floer homology of the Miller fiber for S different from zero, but this is the homology of the Miller fiber of the projectivized tangent pole. And the same is here, so we can correct Sarisky question B. So the right formulation for Sarisky question B is that if the mu is constant, then the Milner fiber of the function that the projectivized tangent cone of the initial function has to be have the same homology. Mm-hmm.